I was having a conversation with one of my friends on Monday about the recent Colorado wildfires and just how terrible they've been and how much of an utter devastation they have brought upon the people and the homes and everything in Colorado. And the wildfires have been across the United States because of the dryness and the heat, but this particular talk was centered around that. And the reason we talked specifically about Colorado is I'd seen this news article in which news talked about what they should do as they're evacuating. Because everyone had been on high alert, they knew it was dry, they knew it was hot, and they knew that there was a potential for wildfires. And they talked about, in this article, evacuation procedures and how they should go about. And that as people were beginning to evacuate, what they should do is grab only five things of importance. Upon hearing that they had to evacuate, they should grab five things of importance before they would start to get out of danger. For the two of us, this raised several questions. And the first is the general question that most people have when they think about it is what five things would you grab? Like in your house, what five things when disaster is coming upon you, what are the five things that you would grab? But a second and more obvious question that came to us is, why would you wait until the last minute to grab the things that were important to you to evacuate out of danger? You know that the wildfires had the potential to be there. You know that you were in a dangerous situation, and yet you waited until the very last minute and said, I gotta grab something quick because I'm really worried about losing it. These wildfires, while devastating, they weren't a surprise. There was nothing specifically surprising about them because they had been warned. They had been told that there was the chance, there was the possibility. Areas were on high alert. But it took a news article to tell them to grab five things right before evacuating. So with that, two things sprang additionally into my head. Why do we wait when warnings are given? If we receive a warning about something, why do we wait? Why is it that the people of Colorado were expected, though they had gotten these evacuation warnings, why would they have bothered to wait to put the things that were important to them in their trucks or in their cars or set things up so that they'd be ready just in case anything would happen? What gain was there in waiting? This was the question that me and my friend Philip went over. Would it not have been a better idea to pack those few things in the car and, you know, just had them in there, and then in case something does happen, you're all set and ready to go? But I think a better question is, why are we so worried about things that when the disaster is upon us, that our concern is those things that we need to grab and not specifically about our life? Why would we bother waiting, and why would we wait to make sure that the thing we were protecting was goods? And I think the reason is found in today's text. And I think the overall reason on how we can fall into this mistake is found throughout 1 John. But today we close up 1 John, the very interesting text, in verse 21. So if you'll turn with me to 1 John, chapter 5, verse 21, as we close the book of 1 John, we read, "Little children, keep yourselves from idols." I just want to read that in the context of the whole paragraph so you can just feel this last little verse one more time. "And we know that the Son of God has come and has given us understanding so that we may know him who is true, and we are in him who is true, in his Son, Jesus Christ. He is the true God and eternal life. Little children, keep yourselves from idols. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, you are the true God and the eternal life. And today we read in your word the call, the command that that John gave us in this letter, that we should keep ourselves from idols. This is a strange way to close the letter of 1 John. And we ask that as we look upon this verse, we consider this book, let's consider this letter, that we would follow the truth and the importance that it puts before us. Help us, O Lord, to keep ourselves from idols. Show us, O Lord, how to keep ourselves from idols. And grow in us an understanding, O Lord, of the devastation and the destruction that idols can bear in our lives. We pray this all in your Son's holy name. Amen. To say the very least, 1 John ends in a very peculiar manner. This is a strange ending to a book. And I have this memory of listening through books of the Bible at my job. I would just turn on a book and just listen to it several times through and just have it on repeat. And I remember listening to 1 John without, just as I was walking around doing work at our company, I remember listening to it, and it would get to this verse, and it would begin again, and I'd say, well, did I miss a portion? Did something happen? I've just become confused, because I heard him make a reference to idols, and it seems like he's starting a new train of thought, but he's just done. He's just done. Done with the book. So that leads us to several questions. Was this just a peculiar ending? Was this just a strange ending that John had? Or was it purposeful? Did he have a reason behind this? Did he end this the way he did intentionally? The answer is yes to both questions. It is peculiar, no doubt about it. This is a very strange ending to a book. Was it purposeful? Did he have a reason to end this way? Additionally, yes. How do we know those are the answers to the questions? First off, we know it because it fits the overall purpose of the book, and it fits the context of the audience. I want to start there with the context of the audience. Idolatry is an issue that is faced by both the recipients of the letter of 1 John, but also us today. We're going to look more at what an idol specifically is, but we have to remember that idols are both an issue back then in the first century and today, the 21st century. They were, are, and remain an issue. But additionally, the reason why this is an acceptable yet strange conclusion to the book is that John has talked about this throughout the whole letter. The whole letter of 1 John has had references and connections to this issue of idolatry. I'm not going to give you all the references, but consider what John has instructed them in. He instructed them against being their own savior and claiming that they were sinless. He instructed them against and warned them against continuing freely and rampantly in sin. He warned them against anger and hatred of the brother. He warned them against the power of the world, the lust of the eyes, lust of the flesh, and the pride of life. He warned them against antichrists and false gospels. He warned them against being lawless and doing whatever oneself desires to do. He warned them against self-condemnation. And he warned them against denial of God. And in warning them, John was not saying, you have this little struggle with sin. Beat that and you'll be fine. That was not what his warning was. His warning was, bringing them to understand that they struggle with inherent idolatry. That behind these specific things, behind being the desire to be their own savior and claim that they were sinless, was not a misunderstanding, but rather a worship of self. The problem of anger and hatred of brothers was not just a problem of anger that they just had to deal with, but it was a desire for perfection and a need to serve a God of themselves that had no problems whatsoever. They struggled with idolatry. And I think the best way to think of this is the way we instruct young children. I can remember having problems with cavities as a child. We'll admit that. There was a little bit of a struggle. I still have some of the fillings in my permanent teeth to show it. And I could just have the cavities taken care of. Just every time a cavity comes, I'm just going to get it taken care of. You know, dentist, please, if you just put more sealant in the little crevices, I won't have anything building up there. There will be no problem. Let's just address the cavities as they stand. I will floss more. I will brush my teeth more. I'll use the special toothpaste. And we will address all the issues of cavities. And that may deal with the pain, and that may resolve a little bit of the issue, but that doesn't really solve the problem of why the cavities were coming up in the first place. There was, in fact, a struggle with candy and sugary sodas. We enjoyed them very much as children, and the effects were seen by our mother. And, you know, if that was dealt with, everything else would fall into place. If those issues were decreased, there would no longer be the issue of cavities. Cavities were a result of the problem of candy, of sweets, of just putting sugar on top of your already sugary cereal. Why would we do that? Because it made it delicious. But created worse problems. Candy was the problem. And what John has been telling them throughout the letter of 1 John is that these sins are an issue, but behind those sins stands a greater problem, and it's a problem of idolatry. It's a problem of giving worship and giving esteem and serving something other than God. Which takes us to our question. What is an idol specifically? What is an idol? Think of the first thing that comes to your mind when you think of an idol. I'm pretty sure you just thought of some form of statue. If you thought idol, you probably thought statue. Some kind. I think Easter Island heads. Like, that's the first thing that pops into my mind for some reason. Also, the various idols that we saw in Cambodia concerning the worship of Hindu and Buddhist gods. But I want you to alter that thinking. Because that's true. Those are idols. Those are objects of worship in cultures. But idols are bigger than that. Think of an idol as that thing in your life that steals your time, your love, and your devotion from that which it should properly go to. It could be a project car. Growing up, my brother had a Ford. Oh, man, he's going to be angry at me now. This is bad. He had a Ford Durango, I believe. It's like an El Camino that we worked on a bunch, and it was fun. But if that became the sole thing in Eddie's life other than schoolwork and other than his responsibilities as a son, you know what would have happened in the Strubing house? Bye-bye, project car. Sad Eddie. It could be the project car. It could be the scrapbook. Ladies, scrapbooking is lovely, but if you don't have memories to put in the scrapbook, it's not very purposeful. It could be a feeling of fear. It could be a softball team. It could be a feeling of comfort. It could be a television series. It could be just the general traditions that you have expectations of in life, in weddings, in everything. I mean, we went to this wedding yesterday. I'm sure a lot of people were thinking, this is exactly how it should go. I have an expectation that they will do this, 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 and this, and that is how it will be fulfilled. Most people would have been pleasantly surprised. I loved how much Jeff and Katie, how I could anticipate what was going to happen as the wedding progressed. It was comforting to me. But if I demanded that and went up to a person who had a different wedding and said, you know, your wedding wasn't really a wedding, that would be really bad. It's not something you say to a bride on the wedding day. It could be a career. It could be even a garden. There are things that steal our time, our love, and our devotion. It's an object or activity that begins good and encouraging and was created by God for good. But over time and through corruption have come to steal your life, your love for others, and as we will now see, primarily our devotion to the Lord. And the best explanation in the New Testament comes in Romans 1. Turn with me to Romans 1, because we're going to look here. In the text that we read, I want you to remember, as I'm talking about what happens that creates an idol, I want you to just keep that in the back of your mind. Because in that same path is also the cure for an idol. But chapter 1, verses 18 through 25. I was originally going to start in verse 20, but we're just going to start in 18. And Paul here delineates this path, this road that the idolater stumbles down. We begin in 18. For the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men, who by their unrighteousness suppress the truth. For what can be known about God is plain to them, because God has shown it to them. For his invisible attributes, namely his eternal power and divine nature, have been clearly perceived ever since the creation of the world in the things that have been made. So they are without excuse. For although they knew God, they did not honor him as God or give thanks to him. But they became futile in their thinking, and their foolish hearts were darkened. Claiming to be wise, they became fools and exchanged the glory of the immortal God for images resembling mortal man and birds and animals and creeping things. Therefore, God gave them up in the lusts of their hearts to impurity, to the dishonoring of their bodies among themselves, because they exchanged the truth about God for a lie and worshiped and served the creature rather than the Creator, who is blessed forever. Amen. I'll show you this path. It starts off with them knowing it. They see it. They perceive the eternal God and his attributes through the creation. And they start by suppressing the truth. Though they know it, they suppress that truth. Then after suppressing it, they go on. And despite knowing, they don't honor God. They know and they experience these things and these great and glorious things, and they don't honor God. And they go on with not honoring by not giving thanks to him. And they proceed from there to not only not honor him, to not only not give thanks to him, but to exchange him. To realize these things are true. These are actual things on earth. These created things that reveal great and glorious things. And they say, they don't reveal God. Let's put something else in his place. And they exchange God for images, for representations. It says that they exchange them for these images resembling mortal man and birds and animals and creeping things. So the things that reveal God become the specific gods. In so doing, they exchange truth for a lie. And this is when it gets terrible. Idolatry comes to its head when they worship the idol and they serve the idol. They worship, they serve the creature rather than the Creator. A terrible exchange, a deadly exchange. This is what has been accomplished. Imagine with me a dinner table. A family is at dinner, and they have two children, a boy and a girl. They have little Susie and little Tommy. Susie has a wonderful doll that she loves. She carries her little doll with her wherever she goes. And they get to dinner, and she's sitting there with Susie and combing Susie's hair and talking to Susie the whole time. And she just hugs Susie, and Susie just hugs the doll, and she just loves it and cares for it. And as she eats, she talks to the doll alone. Thanks the doll for everything that she has. Realizes and just loves everything that she has on this plate. Says, "Thank you, Dolly, for everything that you're giving me. You're the best Dolly in the world." And just continues to comb the Dolly's hair and fuss over the Dolly, to pay attention only to the Dolly. On the other side of the table sits Tommy, and Tommy's quiet. Tommy's the quiet type. Just sits there and has his dinner and listens and doesn't really make a fuss. He thinks his silence keeps him safe. If he just stays quiet, he'll be comfortable. He'll have his fill of food. He won't make any waves. And he'll be happy. In the midst of their two separate and different lives, they're doing the exact same thing. They're ignoring the loving parents that gave them the meal. Their fears and intentions and distractions are the things that become their gods. Susie finds so much more happiness in her doll than she does her family. Tommy finds so much more safety in his silence and in his fears than in the possibility that he could get in trouble or he could say the wrong thing. And given time, as they grow up, the Dolly will pass away. Tommy's quiet will have to go. And then what will they have? Will they have that family? Hopefully. Hopefully the repair can come back. But it might just become something else. It might just become something else. The Dolly might be replaced with the things that age brings. And it'll proceed from being a Dolly to being whatever else is popular for the young girl. And for Tommy, his quiet could turn to pain. So idols are a strange thing. And they can be statues, and they can be those totems and things that we think of when we first think of an idol. But there's so much more than that. They are so much deeper and more difficult than everything that the statue itself represents, because the statue itself is nothing. What's strong behind it is the devotion and the love and the care that the person should be giving to the Lord that they've now placed on the idol. Now that we've covered those things, we're going to go back to our passage and think of the most important portion of what John was talking about here. 1 John chapter 5, verse 21 finishes with a command. He says, "Little children, keep yourselves from idols." His command is for us to keep ourselves from those idols. What he doesn't tell us is why or how. He doesn't tell us why or how. So why should we keep ourselves from idols? And Paul gave us that message clearly in 18. I'm just going to read a little bit of 18 quick. It starts off, "For the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men, who by their unrighteousness suppress the truth." The Lord will not share the love that he deserves with another. Because taking that love from God will kill the individual. They will no longer depend on him. They will no longer hope in him. They will no longer seek him. It's like our friends with the Colorado wildfires. If their definition of home was simply the building that they lived in, if that burned down, their life is destroyed. If they grabbed five things and missed one thing of importance, it would haunt them the rest of their days. But if rather home was the family that occupied that house and the lives that they would protect, they'd be safe. So we start keeping ourselves from idols because of the destruction that can come. The wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all unrighteousness. But simultaneously, idols are out to kill you. They're not out to build you up. They may give you some sweetness like candy does. May help you a little bit. You may feel a little bit of satisfaction. But at the end of the day, you're going to crash. You're going to crash. But there's a better picture. Turn with me to Matthew 16. We're going to finish up here. Why keep ourselves from idols? Verse 24 through 27. This is Jesus talking. Then Jesus told his disciples, "If anyone would come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. For whoever would save his life will lose it. But whoever loses his life for my sake will find it. For what will it profit a man if he gains the whole world and forfeits his soul? Or what shall a man give in return for his soul? For the Son of Man is going to come with his angels, the glory of his Father, and then he will repay each person according to what he has done." Imagine that it was your home that you had been warned about. That fire was on the horizon and it was coming to destroy your home. And you chose to stay with it. Your home is precious to you. Homes are precious to people. It's a huge investment. It contains memories. Contains so much of who we are. But what would you do? What would you do? The fire actually came. Would you stand outside with a garden hose and try and fight it off? Would you pack everything into the basement? And if there's any looters that could come, you know, you can protect it, but you know what? Then once the fire's there, you might have a problem. What would you do? What Jesus is saying is that, you know, if you want to save your life, you must lose it. Whoever would save his life will lose it. But whoever loses his life for my sake will find it. What Jesus is saying is that for us, it is better to lose a little in this life and gain your life. It is better to lose a little and gain your life than gain a little and lose your life. Idols are things that we often have a great heart for and we love very deeply and we feel a strong connection to. And the idea of separating ourselves from them can be devastating at first. Because the problem is we're thinking, just think of what I'll lose if I give up on this. Think of what I will lose if I pack a few things into my car and drive away from my home. I will lose my home. And there are devastating pictures of blocks of houses where there'll be 90% of the houses burned up and three that are left standing. Three that are left standing. And the question becomes, if you would have stayed, would it have been worth it? Would your gain of those little things that pass away so quickly have been worth it in comparison to saving the life that you have? So consider what Christ says. Whoever would save his life will lose it. But whoever loses his life for my sake will find it. Which takes us to our next question. How? How? How do we keep ourselves free from idols? First answer is what we said. Lose your life. There are portions of your life that you count more precious than your relationship with Christ. Or there are portions of your life that are distracting you from your relationship with Christ. Give them up. Throw them away. Do not let them hinder you from the relationship. And then out of that relationship, be built up with the expectations that Christ has for you. And the second is like it. First way to keep ourselves from idols is lose your life. The second way to keep ourselves from idols is to find your life in Christ. Find your life in Christ. And this is what we were talking about in Romans 1. Every passage in Romans 1 that referred to the things that people were doing to fall into idolatry, reverse them. Reverse them. Take that stumbling path that was leading people from a path of life and knowing the true God and reverse it. Let the truth reign in your life. Give glory and honor and worship and truly serve the Creator, not the creature. Do not suppress the truth. Know it. Recognize the God who is working in nature, who stands above and beyond everything that we can perceive and know. And find in that worship and in that life and that God everything you would ever need. Take those idols which remain, because the honest fact is that there will be idols that will remain in you. If they reign in you, that's one thing, but there are, for the believer, still idols that reign. Take them, throw them away. Throw them away. They're not worth the house burning down. They're not worth it. They're not worth being consumed by the fire. They're not worth the smoke inhalation. They're not worth all the devastating effects that came through those wildfires. Throw those things away and then find the things in your life which have disconnected you from a loving God and disconnected you from others and live in that. Live in that. And know, idols are takers. They're takers. They may seem like givers, may seem like blessers, they may seem like the best thing that you have. But they give you nothing. They take, they get whatever they can out of you, and they give you nothing. They may present you with the graces and glories and presence and mercies of God that you are receiving in this life, and they claim it as their own. They take credit, plagiarizers, and they will take from you not only your worship, not only your service, but your life as well. And John's desire and Christ's desire in this letter, in the book of 1 John, was not just to end it and say, that was strange. It was a strange letter. Strange ending to a strange letter. That was not his desire. John's desire was our full life, our whole life, to be filled up in Christ. And for our life not to be lost, but rather to be found in our Savior and our God. There is a wildfire on the horizon. Be warned. Be warned. Just like Colorado, there was trouble on the horizon. And a fool would sit and stockpile in hopes that it would never come. A fool would sit and say, I can protect my house from this wildfire with a hose. Don't take that path. Don't go that way. Don't think you can fight the coming of time. Give up on the idol and choose life. love your life, lose it. Lose it. And find it anew in Christ. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for your love, your life, for everything that you would communicate to us by your Spirit through this book, and for the fact that in you, and in the worship and the service of you, is life and life everlasting and the fullness of joy. Lord, we thank you that you truly are indescribable, and that the portions of joy and happiness that we see on this side of heaven are nothing in comparison to that which you would reveal when the fullness of time has come. Prepare us, O Lord, and give us hearts that would serve and worship you, and that would allow no idol to either rule or reign in our life. It's in your name we pray. Amen.